Imagine if the only option for a little girl that wants to play sports is cheerleading. If your female friend or family member got kicked out of college for being pregnant or wasn't even allowed to go to college because of her gender. If sexual assault on college campuses weren't acknowledged. If that sounds unappealing or unimaginable, then Title IX and those responsible for it deserve credit for this no longer being a reality. Prior to Title IX passing in 1972, all of these situations were allowed and common for women to experience in the United States. Title IX is important because it gave women the same rights as men to play sports, have the right to get an equal education, and protection from sexual harassment. Many activists and legislators worked to make Title IX the law of the land. Legislators Edith Green and Patsy Ming, along with activist Bernice Sandler, took a stand for women's rights by working to pass Title IX. These three women that took a stand rarely received the credit they deserved for the historic role they played in creating and protecting Title IX. Their stand to pass Title IX and protect it from being watered down led to women having equal rights and access to participate in sports and access to a proper education and legal protections for sexual assault.
Before Title IX was passed, women playing sports was frowned upon. They had limited sports to choose from. Women were told they should be dancers instead of sports players. In athletics, girls and women dealt with discrimination, racism, prejudice, and ridicule. A woman could not get a credit card on her own bank account or even get a bank account. They could not serve on a jury and could not get birth control. Women also couldn't get an Ivy League education until 1969. Before Title IX, the number of female college athletics was less than 30,000 compared to the 200,000 today. They studied home economics instead of training for, quote, male-oriented job. Girls could become nurses and teachers, but not doctors or principals. There was no such thing as sexual harassment 40 years ago because, quote, boys will be boys, and sexual assault wasn't taken seriously, and if a student got pregnant, her education ended and it was her fault. During the passage of Title IX, there were many feminists and other activists fighting for a change. During the early 1960s, the women's rights movement began with the publication of The Feminine Mystique. The movement grew in popularity throughout the rest of the 1960s. Women were fighting for equal pay, the right to use contraceptive, and to have an equal place in society. The women that led this movement and the changes they created made Title IX possible.
While Patsy Mink and Green later introduced the legislation to Congress. Alongside these people working to get this law passed was Bernice Sandler, an activist for Title IX. Despite the fact that all three of these women played an important role, Birch Bayh usually gets the most credit for Title IX and is referred to as the father of Title IX. Bernice Sandler advocated for protection from discrimination, sexual harassment, and equality in schools. She filed hundreds of complaints about how universities were discriminating against women. Sandler and Edith Green were first to propose Title IX. Sandler had a personal incident that inspired her to become an activist.
I wanted to be a professor. I wanted to teach. I love to teach. I got into women's issues because I was teaching, you know, a course or two all the time. I was getting my doctorate at Maryland in the School of Education, and I love teaching. And finally got my doctorate and was still teaching. And they had seven openings and didn't even think of me at all. I wasn't even considered. And I really am a good dynamic teacher and so forth. So I asked, I went to one of the guys and I said, you know, they didn't even think of me. I need to know why. And then he said without skipping a beat, let's face it, Bunny, you come on too strong for a woman. And I went home and I cried. Yes, I never should have opened my mouth in graduate school. I used to, you know, was an active participant in the class and so forth. And my then husband was really quite good on this issue, and he said, are there strong men in the department? And I remember weeping and saying yes, you know, in tears. When he said, then it's not you, it's sex discrimination. And that had not occurred to me, and it took me a few weeks to put it together that something bad had happened and it was called sex discrimination. Up until that point, I was not interested in women's issues. I mean, I thought these were women, if they were, I hate to say this publicly, but it's true, it was true of a lot of women who did not believe there was discrimination because, after all, they compared themselves not to men, but they compared themselves to other women. But, you know, in colonial days, if you were female and you left your husband, you could be arrested for stealing his clothes that you were wearing, and you probably never saw your children again. So the laws on women were really quite bad, and now people have a name for it, discrimination, which becomes very important because you could see it and understand it in a different way. And saying that I came on too strong for a woman was what really made the difference in my understanding.
Edith Green believed that, quote, A woman has to work twice as hard as a man to prove that she can do the job. This was her main drive that focused her to draft the legislation that would even the scales between the sexes. Two of her main concerns as a representative were pay equity and gender equality in post-secondary education, which resulted in the passage of the Equal Pay Act in 1963. Although pleased by the passage of the groundbreaking bill, Green expressed that it took 8 years to persuade Congress that a woman doing identical work with a man ought to be paid the same salary. Patsy Mink applied to 20 medical schools, both in Hawaii and on the U.S. mainland, but was rejected by all of them, ostensibly because of her sex. "It was the most devastating disappointment of my life," she recalled in the documentary, Patsy Mink, Ahead of the Majority. "That I could have spent my whole educational experience, you know, geared toward one thing, and then have all the schools I wrote to say, no, can't have you." Negative life experiences like that and many others led Mink, once she was in Congress, to work on issues related to women, education, and equality. Her daughter, Wendy Mink, said her hope was that the next generation would not endure the same obstacles that she had to encounter.
Title IX states that, quote, "No person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any education program or activity receiving federal financial assistance." Title IX didn't face a lot of controversy as it worked its way through Congress. The law overwhelmingly passed. Controversy came after, when regulations were being written to implement and enforce Title IX. Many male athletic directors and coaches were upset because they believed it would cut funding from men's athletics and force schools to have less male athletes. These feelings led some in Congress to try and water down the law by attempting to pass an amendment stating Title IX shouldn't apply to college athletics. Men's coaches and members of Congress tried for 3 years to get men's athletics exempt from this law. Congresswoman Mink took a stand to preserve the original intent of the law.
For 3 years, men's coaches lobbied to exempt college sports from Title IX. In July 1975, the final decision whether to keep sports part of Title IX came up for a vote. As debate began in the House, Mink got devastating news. Her daughter Gwendolyn was thrown through the windshield of a car.
She got this horrendous call in the cloakroom. So she went back and she just went right out the door, as she should. We said, get out of here, go, you know. So then there was the vote, and obviously she didn't show up on the roll call.
The consequence of her leaving is that the principle of full equality for women in education died that day. Our side lost that vote by one vote.
Mink, however, had a key ally, House Speaker Carl Albert. Because of Mink's family emergency, Albert scheduled a revote. With the Congresswoman back on the floor, this time the regulations to keep sports part of Title IX passed by 37 votes.
Since Title IX's passage, the law has had a major positive impact on women. Women have had equal access to a higher education, can no longer be discriminated for being a pregnant college student, female college employees are no longer paid less and relegated to women's colleges, women have access to all college classes and sports, and colleges are now legally obligated to report and handle all sexual harassment complaints. The late, great Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan called Title IX one of the most important pieces of education legislation in the history of the Republic.
Well, my experiences go back primarily to athletics since I've been at Humboldt. So when I first came to Humboldt in 1980, I was coaching men's soccer. Mm-hmm. And at the time when I came, there was a structure where the men coaches had a staff meeting and the women coaches of women's sports had a staff meeting. So it was a completely kind of separated program. And when I first got here, that changed and it became one.
Title IX hasn't solved all gender inequity issues in higher education, but the stand that Bernice Sandler, Edith Green, and Patsy Meek took to make gender equality in higher education the law of the land has positively affected the lives of millions of women and changed American society for the better.